Good evening. My name is Dr. Richard Curtis. I'm a professor of philosophy here in town, and I did my PhD with colleagues of Dr. Griffin in Claremont, California. On behalf of 9/11 Truth Seattle, I'd like to welcome you to Town Hall. In an interesting new book called The Undercover Philosopher, A Guide to Detecting Shams, Lies, and Distortions, Michael Phillips makes the following observation. While it's certainly the case that experts can and do recognize contrary evidence, this is not an easy task for non-experts. Generally, we hold to beliefs once formed, and when contrary information comes along, we hold on to the old belief since we have lost track of why we believe the old belief. The difference with experts is that they usually keep track of the reasons for a given belief. People in general, though, are good at ignoring contrary evidence, or they just get defensive. The key variable is what we take to be our interest in the truth. Tonight, we will explore a version of this phenomenon. In the extreme version tonight, we will hear about otherwise rational people adopting miraculous explanations for stories they have heard and accepted, but have lost track of their reasons for accepting. At one level, this is all very ordinary. It's very human. At another level, it's deeply disturbing that people can be so determined to hold on to beliefs absent evidence or in the face of contrary evidence. And having a political class that doesn't mind lying is no help either. Tonight, at least, we will not accept the lies reflexively. We will confront them. Tonight, at least, we will engage science, engage facts, engage reason, and ask what we can know, what we ought to doubt, and what we should believe if we are to think like experts rather than dupes. To guide us in this exploration is Dr. David Ray Griffin, world-famous professor emeritus of philosophy of religion and theology at Claremont School of Theology and the School of Religion at Claremont Graduate University, my alma mater. Dr. Griffin is the author of 11's books questioning various aspects of the official 9/11 myth and has written or edited dozens of others in his long and distinguished career. Since 2004, Dr. Griffin has been known as the Dean of 9/11 Studies and the conscience of the 9/11 Truth Movement. He was near death only a year ago, and we're quite lucky to have him back with us and back for this very special presentation, his first lecture since that illness. He is a courageous and tenacious fighter for truth, justice, and reason. His talk tonight, 9/11, Why Do Bill Moyers and Robert Parry Believe in Miracles? Please welcome me now, welcoming back to Seattle, Dr. David Ray Griffin.
Thank you very much. It's nice to be back in Seattle. I spoke here in 2007. This is one of the happiest events I've had with the 9/11 adventure. And the video that came from that lecture, 9/11, Let's Get Empirical, turned out to be the favorite of my DVDs. It has now been almost 10 years since the 9/11 attacks. A few people from the beginning started saying that the official account of the attacks, according to which they were carried out by foreign Muslims in other countries, was false, and that 9/11 was an inside job carried out by people and agencies in our own government. An emerging movement to make this case came to be called the 9/11 Truth Movement. This movement argued from the beginning that 9/11 was a false flag attack designed to allow the Bush-Cheney administration and its Pentagon to attack Afghanistan and then Iraq. But most of the traditional anti-war journalists, such as Noam Chomsky, George Monbiot, Norman Solomon, and Matt Taibbi, along with the writers at Counterpunch, In These Times, The Nation, Mother Jones, The Progressive, and Democracy Now!, did not endorse the 9/11 Truth Movement. Most of them, in fact, attacked it. In the first years, to be sure, we did not have a very impressive membership. Our movement had few professionals in the relevant disciplines, such as physics, architecture, and engineering. But in 2005, physics professor Stephen Jones started explaining why the World Trade Center buildings could not have come down without explosives. Due to some books and coverage by C-SPAN, professional organizations began to form, including Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth. By now, we have a dozen professional organizations, including Firefighters for 9/11 Truth, Intelligence Officers for 9/11 Truth, Journalists for 9/11 Truth, Medical Professionals for 9/11 Truth, Military Officers for 9/11 Truth, Political Leaders for 9/11 Truth, Religious Leaders for 9/11 Truth, Scientists for 9/11 Truth, and Veterans for 9/11 Truth. The 9/11 Truth Movement is now very impressive in both size and professional membership. Nevertheless, the traditional anti-war leadership has continued to distance itself from the 9/11 movement. There have been a few notable exceptions, including Richard Falk and former CIA analysts Bill Christensen and Ray McGovern. But most of the anti-war leaders have maintained the stance they took in the first years after 9/11, in spite of all the changes in the 9/11 Truth Movement in the intervening years. For example, when I was interviewed by On Democracy Now! In 2004, the main argument against my position was that I could not name one structural engineering expert who said it is not feasible that the planes caused the towers to come down. The movement's lack of architects and engineers at that stage constituted a persuasive argument. But now there are 1,500 members of Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth who say it is not feasible that the planes caused the towers to go down. So one would suppose that Democracy Now! Would have reassessed its position, but it has not. Progressive journalists in general have not availed themselves of the evidence provided by the 9/11 Truth Movement to argue against the legitimacy of the so-called war on terror. If any major journalist could have been expected to do so, it would have been Bill Moyers. Moyers began his public life by working for President Lyndon Johnson, ending up as the White House press secretary. But having become increasingly opposed to Johnson's war in Vietnam, Moyers resigned in 1966. Next, becoming the publisher of Newsday, Moyers turned this conservative paper into a progressive organ, which in 5 years won 33 journalistic awards, including 2 Pulitzer Prizes. Then, after a brief stint at CBS, Moyers spent most of the rest of his professional life at PBS, producing and writing the Bill Moyers Journal. In these programs, Moyers argued that democracy cannot coexist with a permanent war state. His 2007 program on the secret government exposed ways in which presidents have deceived the people to promote war. And another 2007 program, Buying the War, showed that the media, instead of exposing truths that could have prevented the war in Iraq, served as cheerleaders. However, while driving home the fact that the media failed to expose Saddam Hussein's lack of weapons of mass destruction, Moyers failed to expose Osama bin Laden's lack of responsibility for the 9/11 attacks. And then in 2011, he attacked the 9/11 Truth Movement after criticizing Rush Limbaugh and Fox News for providing disinformation that undermines the truth needed for democratic self-government. Moyers added, "Disinformation is not unique to the right. Like other journalists, I have been the object of malevolent assaults from the 9/11 truthers for not reporting their airtight case, proving that the Bush administration conspired to bring about the attacks on the World Trade Center." In speaking about this airtight case, Moyers was, of course, using sarcasm, considering this case anything but airtight. In fact, he said that the truthers, having no real evidence, simply cherry-picked a few supposed anomalies to build an inside job storyline. In criticizing this case, Moyers was paraphrasing independent journalist Robert Parry, who said, "Lacking any real evidence, the truthers have built their case on alleged anomalies in the collapse of the buildings." In drawing on Parry, Moyers appealed to one of the best of the independent journalists. Having helped to reveal the Iran-Contra affair, and having been the first journalist to report Oliver North's involvement, Parry received the George Polk Award for Journalism in 1984 and was a finalist for a Pulitzer the following year. In 1995, having resigned from both the Associated Press and Newsweek because they put brakes on stories he wanted to report, he created Consortium News, the first online magazine of investigative journalism. What distinguishes Parry's project from the mass media's cyber ventures, Norman Solomon wrote, is his passionate belief that journalism has a responsibility to follow the trail of the truth wherever it leads. In 2004, explaining the motivation behind Consortium News, Parry wrote, "The consortiumnews.com website was meant to be a home for important, well-reported stories that weren't welcome in the conventional, wisdom-driven national news media. I was distressed by the silliness that had pervaded American journalism by the mid-1990s. I feared, too, that the decline of the U.S. press corps foreshadowed disasters that would come when journalists failed to alert the public from impending dangers." In concluding that 2004 essay, Parry said, "The fight for honest information is a battle for the future of American democracy." Given Parry's commitments, we would have expected him to expose the truth about 9/11. And there's still another reason why we should have expected this. After Parry had won his awards for reporting about the Iran-Contra affair, he delved more deeply into this story, finding evidence to support the theory that the Reagan-Bush administration's contact with the Iranian government of Ayatollah Khomeini had begun years earlier, during the 1980 presidential campaign. President Jimmy Carter was trying to negotiate the release of U.S. citizens being held hostages by the Iranian government. The Republicans reportedly feared that Carter would arrange an October surprise, a last-minute release of the hostages, which would guarantee Carter's re-election. But Parry moved toward the theory that the Reagan-Bush campaign had worked out a different October surprise, according to which the Iranians, in exchange for weapons for their war with Iraq, would hold the hostages until after the elections, thereby virtually guaranteeing victory by the Republicans. But Parry publicly endorsed this view only after he had investigated the claims for himself, uncovering additional evidence. Having left Newsweek in 1990 after it insisted that Parry quit reporting about Iran-Contra, he was approached by PBS's Frontline to do a special about the October surprises allegations. Parry knew his career would be improved if he joined other journalists in debunking the charge that the Reagan-Bush ticket had won the election by means of a dirty trick. However, finding multiple testimonies that George Bush, then the Republican vice presidential candidate, and Bill Casey, the Republican campaign chairman, met with Iranians in Madrid and Paris in 1980. His 1991 Frontline program, which came the same week as a New York Times op-ed by Iranian expert Gary Sick, led to a congressional investigation. But these allegations were widely denounced in the press, and Democratic Congressman Lee Hamilton, who headed the Congressional Task Force, declared that the theory of a secret deal had no credible evidence. In reality, there was a lot of evidence. The brother of Iranian banker Cyrus Hashimi said that he and his brother had met with Casey in Madrid on July 27 and 28, 1980. And testimony that Bush and Casey had met with Iranian officials was provided by former Iranian president Bani Sadr, by Russian intelligence, and by the biographer of France's chief of intelligence. However, Hamilton and his chief counsel, Lawrence Barcella, hid some of this evidence and disputed the rest of it by means of false claims and ludicrous alibis. For example, Newsweek and the New Republic declared that Casey could not have been in Madrid on July 27 and 28 because he was at a historical conference in London. The press declared this evidence proved the October surprise to be a myth. However, the attendance sheet for this London conference, Parry discovered, showed that Casey did not arrive until 4 p.m. on the 28th, so he could have had meetings in Madrid on July 27 and 28, as the witnesses had testified. Although Newsweek and the New Republic, confronted with this disproof of their claim, refused to print retractions, Lee Hamilton simply sought a better alibi for Casey. His task force claimed that from July 25 to 27, Casey had been at the Bohemian Grove near San Francisco, after which he flew overnight to London in time to arrive at the historical conference by 4 p.m. on the 28th. However, documentary evidence showed that Casey attended the Bohemian Grove in August, not in July. Hamilton's task force, nevertheless, stuck with the Bohemian Grove alibi. One task force member, Democratic Representative Merv Dimily, recognized the absurdity of the alibis and planned to dissent. But Hamilton used threats to get him to remain silent. So the task force's report was accepted without dissent. Hamilton then wrote a New York Times op-ed entitled "Case Closed," in which he stated that the task force's findings should put the controversy to rest once and for all. Consequently, Parry wrote, Washington's conventional wisdom quickly solidified around the judgment that the October surprise story was a loony conspiracy theory. However, in spite of this conventional wisdom, Parry did not recant. Indeed, he founded consortiumnews.com in large part because of new documents that put the history of the 1980s in a new light, showing especially that the Reagan-Bush team had won the presidency in 1980 by virtue of a dirty trick that bordered on treason. But the press continued to hold, Parry wrote, that the October surprise story was a bogus conspiracy theory, despite the fact that many of the same Reagan figures had been caught lying about the secret Iran-Contra guns for hostages negotiations in 1985 and 86. Parry's continuing insistence on the truth and importance of the October surprise, wrote a sympathetic journalist in 1996, has made him persona non grata in the media establishment. Parry himself said, "It used to be that you were admired if you took on a tough story. Now you're portrayed as a nut." Given Parry's commitment to truthful journalism, combined with his awareness that the October surprise became relegated to the status of bogus conspiracy theory only because of lying politicians and careless and dishonest journalists, we would have expected him to engage in meticulous reporting about the 9/11 truth movement's descent from the official story about the 9/11 attacks. We would have expected him to be suspicious of the official account because it was provided by the Bush-Cheney administration, which is now known to have lied about Iraq. And we would have expected Parry to be even more suspicious about the official story of 9/11 because the chief of the lying politicians in the October surprise case, Lee Hamilton, served as the Democratic co-chair of the 9/11 Commission. Moreover, Parry could have learned in a book on the commission by New York Times writer Philip Sheenan that Hamilton's duplicitous ways continued in his new role. Hamilton, together with Republican co-chair Thomas Kane, appointed Philip Zelikow to be the commission's executive director, even though Zelikow was essentially a member of the Bush White House. Hamilton also, with Kane, concealed from the staff the fact that Zelikow had written a detailed outline of the commission's final report, complete with chapter headings, subheadings, and sub-subheadings before the staff even had its first meeting. For all of these reasons, we would have expected Parry, as well as Moyers, to have done good reporting about the 9/11 attacks. They instead used bad reporting to attack the 9/11 truth movement's claims that 9/11 was an inside job. Both Moyers and Parry, as we saw earlier, said that the truthers had rejected the official account of 9/11 on the basis of alleged or supposed anomalies. Anomalies, coming from the word nomos, refers to occurrences that are exceptions to the norms, rules, or regularities. In saying that the 9/11 truth movement speaks of supposed or alleged anomalies in the collapse of the World Trade Center, Moyers and Parry were saying, that the official account, according to which the buildings were brought down by the airliners and the resulting fires, contained no real anomalies, no exceptions to the regularities of physics and chemistry, no miracles. In truth, the official account of the destruction of the World Trade Center contains many anomalies, and some of them are so obviously and violently contrary to the laws of science that they must be called miracles. Insofar as Moyers and Parry endorse the official account of the destruction of the World Trade Center, they accept all of these miracles. I will point out six of them. First, when people talk about the World Trade Center, they usually have in mind the Twin Towers. But a third building came down that day, a 47-story building two blocks from the Twin Towers, World Trade Center 7, which came down at 5:21 in the afternoon. Many people have not even known that Building 7 came down because it was seldom, if ever, shown on television after that first day, and it was not even mentioned in the 9/11 Commission's report. Why this silence? On the one hand, scientists working for the government needed to say, in accord with the claim that the 9/11 attacks were engineered by Al-Qaeda terrorists, that the World Trade Center was not destroyed by explosives, but was entirely destroyed by the airliner crashes and the resulting fires. On the one hand, it was hard for the government scientists to give this explanation for Building 7, because it was not hit by a plane. It seemed that the building must have been brought down by fire alone. But fire had never brought down a building of this type. New York Times reporter James Glantz, calling the collapse of Building 7 a mystery, said, "Experts said no building like it, a modern steel reinforced high-rise, had ever collapsed because of an uncontrolled fire." Worse yet, for the official account, the fact that Building 7 was not hit by a plane meant that there was no jet fuel to ignite big fires throughout the building. There were not many fires, and were not very big. Trying to make Building 7 seem similar to the Twin Towers, defenders of the official account suggested that flaming debris from the collapse of the North Tower ignited diesel fuel stored in the building, turning Building 7 into a towering inferno so hot that its steel beams and columns were weakened. FEMA, which wrote the first official report about the World Trade Center, called this its best hypothesis. But, FEMA added, this hypothesis had only a low probability of occurrence, which of course is scientific speak for there's no way that could have happened. Popular mechanics nevertheless promoted this hypothesis, telling its readers that the official report by NIST, the National Institute of Standards and Technology, would say that Building 7's diesel fuel had fed the fires for up to 7 hours. In a second effort to make Building 7's collapse similar to that of the Twin Towers, popular mechanics said that although this building was not hit by a plane, it was far more compromised by falling debris than the FEMA report indicated. Popular mechanics thereby intended to refute the 9/11 truth movement's claim that the official account is implausible by virtue of portraying Building 7 as the only steel-framed high-rise to have come down because of fire alone. So they were saying it wasn't just from fire alone, it was from this enormous destruction of the much of the building. However, when NIST finally released its Building 7 report in 2008, it had rejected Popular Mechanics' twofold explanation in terms of diesel fuel and structural damage. NIST said, fuel oil fires did not play a role in the collapse of World Trade Center 7. NIST also said, other than initiating the fires in World Trade Center 7, the damage from the debris from the North Tower had little effect. Building 7, said NIST reports, was the first known instance of fire causing the total collapse of a tall building. NIST thereby said exactly what Popular Mechanics had assured its readers NIST would not say. Therefore, if World Trade Center 7 was brought down by fire without the aid of explosives, this was definitely an anomaly. If Moyers and Parry endorse the official view of this building, do they not thereby endorse a miracle? I turn now to a second anomaly, which even more clearly violates laws of science. Building 7 collapsed symmetrically, meaning that it came straight down, having an almost perfectly horizontal roof line. In order for this symmetrical collapse to occur, all 82 of the steel columns supporting the building had to fail simultaneously. It is difficult to imagine how this symmetry could have resulted without explosives. Perhaps people may think that if the building had been entirely engulfed by fire, so that the fire was symmetrical, all 82 of its columns might have failed simultaneously, producing a symmetrical collapse. History teaches, however, that it is impossible for fire to cause a steel frame building to collapse. It would have been even more obviously impossible for the fires of Building 7, being on only a few floors, to have produced a symmetrical collapse. To believe these asymmetrical fires produced a symmetrical collapse would be to believe in a miracle. The fire also could not explain the sudden onset of Building 7's collapse. Even if we believe that the fire could have caused the steel to lose its strength, the fire would have weakened the steel gradually, causing it to start sagging. But they did not. One moment, the building was perfectly immobile. The next moment, as videos show, it was coming down at full speed. As Australian scientist Frank Legge has observed, there is no sign of a slow start that would be expected if collapse was caused by the gradual softening of the steel. These two characteristics of Building 7's collapse, the symmetrical pattern and the sudden onset, are characteristics of a controlled implosion in which incendiaries and explosives are used to slice the building's steel support columns so as to cause the building to come straight down. The reason to implode a building, rather than simply causing it to fall over sideways, is to avoid damaging nearby buildings. Engineering an implosion, in the words of a controlled demolition website, is by far the trickiest type of explosive project, which only a handful of blasting companies in the world possess enough experience to perform. Mark Loiseau, the president of Controlled Demolition Incorporated, has explained why. To bring a building down so no other structure is harmed, the demolition must be completely planned using the right explosive and the right pattern of laying the charges. If Moyers and Parry hold that Building 7 came down without the aid of explosives, then they are stuck with the conclusion that scattered fires in this building produced a collapse that perfectly imitated the kind of controlled implosion that could be performed by only a few companies in the world. They are stuck, in other words, with a miracle. Three, a third feature of Building 7's collapse would need to be classified as a miracle if we accept the view that the building was brought down by fire. This is the fact that the building came down in absolute free fall for over 2 seconds. Although the 9/11 truth movement has long been pointing out that this building descended at the same rate as a free-falling object, at least virtually so, NIST had long denied this. As late as August 2008, when NIST issued its report on Building 7 in the form of a draft for public comment, it claimed that the time it took for the floors to come down was approximately 40% longer than the computed free fall time. This, NIST added, was consistent with physical principles, meaning consistent with the laws of physics. As this statement implied, any assertion that the building did come down in free fall would not be consistent with basic laws of physics, assuming, of course, that explosives were not used. Shyam Sunder, who was in charge of NIST's World Trade Center reports, explained why. The fact that Building 7 came down much slower than freefall, Sunder said, is not at all unusual because there was structural resistance that was provided, and you had a sequence of structural failures that had to take place. Everything was not instantaneous. However, Sunder's claim was challenged by physicist David Chandler. Sunder's 40% longer claim, Chandler said, contradicted a publicly visible, easily measurable quantity. Chandler then provided a video on the internet showing that by measuring this publicly visible quantity, anyone understanding elementary physics could see that for about 2.5 seconds, the acceleration of the building is indistinguishable from free fall. Given this usual behavior, we might have expected it simply to ignore Chandler's challenge. But in his final report, NIST admitted freefall. Dividing the building's descent into 3 stages, NIST described the second phase as a freefall descent over approximately 8 stories at gravitational acceleration for approximately 2.25 seconds, 2.25 seconds. NIST thereby accepted Chandler's position, except for stating that the time in which the building was in free fall was only 2.25 rather than 2.5 seconds. Trivial difference. NIST thereby affirmed, without explicitly admitting it, that if no explosives were used, the descent of Building 7 was inconsistent with the principles of physics. Chandler explained why, saying,
Freefall can only be achieved if there is zero resistance to the motion.
The top floor of Building 7 would have encountered tremendous resistance from the steel structure of the lower 46 floors, unless that structure had been removed by explosives. Shyam Sunder himself, assuming that explosives were not used, had said in August that a freefall descent of Building 7 would have been impossible because a free-falling object would be one that has no structural components below it to offer resistance. But in November, NIST stated in its final report exactly what Sundar had explained to be impossible. While continuing to insist that no explosives were used, NIST now stated that Building 7 came down in free fall for over 2 seconds. And in making that change, NIST no longer used the language, and this is consistent with physical principles. That phrase they had used repeatedly in the preliminary report, they canceled every one of those. So they didn't explicitly assert that what they were saying was consistent with physics. So they implicitly admitted that what they're now saying is inconsistent, that free fall without explosives is inconsistent with physics. So therefore, NIST implicitly declared that a miracle had happened. 4. Miracles are also implied by the official account of the destruction of the Twin Towers. According to this account, they came down because of 3 and only 3 causes: the airplane impacts, which caused structural damage, the ensuing fires, which were initially fed and spread by jet fuel, and gravity. One of the miracles implicit in this account is that although each building had 287 steel support columns, 240 perimeter columns, and 47 massive core columns, and although explosives were not used to remove these columns, each building came down, as NIST put it, essentially in free fall. NIST tried to explain this by saying that each airliner took out several perimeter and core columns at its area of impact and also created huge fires, which began weakening the steel. After a period of time, 56 minutes for the South Tower and 102 minutes for the North Tower, the massive top section of each building at and above the fire and impact floors fell down on the lower section, which could not resist the tremendous energy released by the downward movement. So you had the plane going in, knocking out a hole in the building. And so then you divide the building into the top part and the lower part. And the argument was then that pretty soon the top part fell down on the lower part, and that's what caused the whole building to collapse. The lower section, NIST claimed, was unable to stop or even slow the falling mass. I've sometimes used the analogy: you're driving down the freeway in your little sports car, and you didn't notice there's a semi stopped in the freeway ahead of you. And so going at 80 miles an hour, you run into the back of the semi. Well, of course, you know what would happen. You start pushing the semi down the freeway at 80 miles an hour. That's exactly what they're arguing happened here. This theory, as Jim Hoffman has said, requires us to believe that the massive steel frames of the lower structure of the towers provided no more resistance to falling rubble than would air. A letter to NIST by scientists stated, basic principles of engineering would dictate, for example, the conservation of momentum principle, would dictate that the undamaged steel structure below the collapse initiation zone would at the very least resist and slow the downward movement of the stories above. I mean, this is basic, this is sixth grade physics. This is Isaac Newton. You know, this is nothing fancy. There is indeed a good chance, they continued, that the structural strength of the steelwork below would arrest, that is, stop, the downward movement of the stories above altogether. In claiming, therefore, that each of the twin towers came down essentially in free fall, without the aid of explosives, NIST implied enormous violations of the conservation of momentum. The descent of each of the twin towers in close to free fall was, therefore, a miracle. Five. Each of the twin towers produced still another miracle. The collapse of each tower began with a massive explosion near the top, during which huge sections of perimeter columns were ejected out 500 to 600 feet. Some of these sections of steel implanted themselves in neighboring buildings, as can be seen in videos and photographs. Enormous force would have been needed to eject huge sections of steel that far out. What could have produced this force? According to NIST, as we have seen, there were only three causal factors: the airplane impacts, the fires, and gravity. The airplane impacts could not have produced the ejections because those impacts had occurred an hour or more earlier. The horizontal ejections could not have been produced by gravity because gravity pulls things straight down. So the ejections must have been produced by fire. And certainly, fire could produce horizontal ejections by causing jet fuel to explode. But the jet fuel, as NIST itself pointed out, had burned up within a few minutes. So what could have happened an hour or more later? Explosives such as RDX or nanothermite could explain these horizontal ejections. According to NIST, however, explosives did not contribute to the destruction of the twin towers. These horizontal ejections, therefore, must be regarded as constituting yet another miracle. Six. Moyers and Parry probably did not think of the fires in the World Trade Center as having miraculous powers. But NIST's account implies they did. Three professors from Worcester Polytechnic Institute issued a report about a piece of steel recovered from Building 7 debris, stating that it had undergone intergranular melting. An expanded version of this report, which contained a description of a similarly eroded piece of steel from one of the twin towers, was included as an appendix to the first official report on the destruction of the World Trade Center, which was issued by FEMA in 2002. A New York Times story noting that parts of those pieces of steel had melted away, even though no fire in any of the buildings was believed to be hot enough to melt steel outright. This story said that these discoveries constituted perhaps the greatest mystery uncovered in the investigation. An article in Worcester's magazine entitled "The Deep Mystery of Melted Steel" said, "Steel, which has a melting point of 2,800 degrees Fahrenheit, may weaken and bend, but does not melt during an ordinary office fire. Yet, a 1-inch column was reduced to 1/2-inch thickness. Its edges, which are curled up like a paper scroll, have been thinned to almost razor sharpness. Gaping holes, some larger than a silver dollar, let light shine through a formerly solid steel flange. This Swiss cheese appearance shocked all of the firewise professors who expected to see distortion and bending, but not holes. One of these professors said that the steel appeared to have been partly evaporated in extraordinarily high temperatures. That the steel had actually evaporated, not merely melted, was also reported by a University of California professor, speaking of a horizontal I-beam from Building 7, he said, "Parts of the flat top of the eye, once 5/8 of an inch thick, had vaporized. The melting point of steel is 2,800 degrees Fahrenheit, and the boiling point is approximately 5,000 degrees Fahrenheit." But NIST said that the fires were ordinary hydrocarbon-based building fires, the maximum temperature of which would be 1,800 degrees Fahrenheit. If Moyers and Parry accept the official story about the World Trade Center buildings, they must believe that these fires had miraculous powers. Further evidence of these miraculous powers was found by the R.J. Lee Group, a scientific research organization that was hired by Deutsche Bank to prove for insurance purposes that the dust contaminating its buildings after 9/11 had resulted from the destruction of the World Trade Center. The R.J. Lee Group showed that the dust in the bank shared the unique chemical signature of the World Trade Center dust in general, part of which was spherical iron particles. The existence of these particles, R.J. Lee said, proved that iron had melted during the World Trade Center event. And yet the melting point of iron is, as we've seen, 2,800 degrees Fahrenheit, whereas ordinary building fires could not have exceeded 1,800 degrees Fahrenheit. The U.S. Geological Survey, so here we have a government agency, made an even more astounding discovery that molybdenum, the melting point of which is 4,753 degrees Fahrenheit, had also melted. Molybdenum is known as a metal with about the highest melting point. So if Moyers and Parry reaffirm the official story, they must assume that the World Trade Center fires had miraculous powers. Moyers and Parry have not, of course, explicitly endorsed miracles. In fact, they would surely deny that the destruction of the World Trade Center involved any miracles. But insofar as they accept the official account, their views of the six phenomena I have discussed violate principles of physics. So these phenomena would have to be classified as miracles. Why would Moyers and Parry accept the official account, even though it implies miracles? One answer might be that they, like many other journalists, have accepted the official view out of fear for their reputations. But Moyers and Parry have repeatedly shown that they have the courage to stand up for truth as they see it, regardless of the consequences. And that's the point of a large part of the point of the stories I was telling you about them. So why did Parry, who was wrongly charged with making baseless accusations about the October surprise, why did he wrongly charge truthers with making unsubstantiated and bizarre claims about controlled demolitions. As we have seen, there is nothing unsubstantiated about the claims that the Twin Towers in Building 7 were brought down by means of explosives. Parry claims that scientists and engineers have provided plausible explanations for the official view. But only a handful of scientists and engineers have stated in print that they see nothing wrong with the official view, and most of them have been dependent upon the government. Remember here Upton Sinclair's famous dictum, "It is difficult to get a man to understand something when his salary depends upon his not understanding it." By contrast, thousands of professionals, including architects, engineers, firefighters, intelligence officers, military officers, and scientists, have publicly stated that the official view cannot be true. I mentioned firefighters. 118 of the 500 members of the New York Fire Department were asked to give oral histories, to give their reports of what they experienced that day. They were not asked questions. They were just told, tell us what you experienced that day. No leading questions. 118 of them volunteered the information that they experienced what seemed to be explosives in the buildings. Parry has unfairly been called a nut because of his persistence in laying out the evidence for the October surprise. Why did he, on the basis of inadequate study, turn around and say to label the truther version of the 9/11 events nutty would seem an understatement? Moyers has done equally poor reporting about 9/11. Observing that America seems more and more unable to deal with reality, Moyers rightly said in his 211 lecture that many people inhabit a closed belief system on whose door they have hung the do not disturb sign. But Moyers' own belief system has evidently made him unable to deal with the reality revealed by the 9/11 truth movement. Moyers' bias against 9/11 truth was manifested 3 years before his 2011 statement. On February 1, 2008, in preparation for the presidential election, the Bill Moyers Journal asked viewers, "What one book do you want your next president to read?" The next week, Moyers named the three books receiving the most votes, while adding, "We detected only one organized campaign against a certain book, and we disqualified it as a result." The book in question, viewers learned the following week, was my 2007 book, Debunking 9/11 Debunking, which was the book that actually received the most votes by far. Was the alleged organized campaign the real reason why this book was disqualified? It would seem not, for three reasons. First, Moyers had not, in explaining the contest, said anything about disallowing organized campaigns. In the second place, the so-called organized campaign consisted entirely of one person writing a statement on 9/11 Blogger, saying that he suspected most members of the 9/11 Truth Movement would be recommending one of Griffin's books. He suggested that they agree on one of them, and he suggested the most recent book, Debunking 9/11 Debunking. I myself played no role in this campaign. Indeed, I did not even know about the contest until it was long over. In the third place, one of the book's authors, Kim Michaels, organized a campaign on behalf of his own book, The Art of Non-War. On his website, he wrote, Bill Moyers is asking viewers to recommend the one book that the next president of the United States should take to the White House. If you feel so inclined, please recommend The Art of Non-War. As a result, Michael's book came in third in the voting, a fact that was used by the publisher to promote the book. However, the Bill Moyers Journal did not eliminate Michael's book from the competition in spite of his self-organized campaign. In justifying the exclusion of my book because of signs of an orchestrated campaign, Moyers said, I wouldn't call it a conspiracy, but I wouldn't call it fair either. But if unfairness was the reason why my book was excluded, the Michael's book, the campaign for which could have easily been detected, should have been excluded. It would seem, therefore, that my book was excluded because Bill Moyers did not want to announce that his program had recommended my book with its claim that 9/11 was an inside job. By taking Moyers' treatment of my book in 2008, together with his 2011 attack on truthers, we can see that he, like Parry, has made charges against the 9/11 truth movement that are not justified by the empirical evidence. I have yet another question for Moyers and Parry. Given their negative characterization of people they call truthers, such as Moyers' statement that they employ sophistry and Parry's charge that they have preposterous notions, one would assume that none of their esteemed friends would have anything good to say about such people. But one of Moyers' most esteemed friends was William Sloan Coffin, who after leaving the CIA became famous as a preacher, an anti-Vietnam War activist, and a leader of the civil rights movement. Moyers interviewed Coffin in 2004 and then spoke at his funeral in 2006. Shortly before his death, Coffin wrote, "All Americans who love their country enough to dig into the facts of these critical times will be well rewarded by examining Professor Griffin's books. 9/11 truth is a very important issue with the power to bring lasting change to our country." Another of Moyers' esteemed friends whom he interviewed is Joseph Huff, who at the time was the president of Union Theological Seminary. Huff wrote a blurb for my first 9/11 book, saying that it ought to be read by any American who values democracy. One of Parry's esteemed friends is Ray McGovern, who as a CIA analyst prepared the president's daily brief for three presidents, and more recently founded Veteran Intelligent Professionals for Sanity. McGovern wrote endorsements for two of my 9/11 books, saying about one of them that he hoped readers did not prefer the comfort of acquiescing to the official version of 9/11 and the imperial wars that it facilitated. How would Moyers and Parry reconcile the comments by these esteemed friends with their negative treatment of truthers? I do not know. But can we at least understand why Moyers and Parry developed such hostility to the 9/11 truth movement? Might the explanation be that the spin machine has been so effective in presenting the 9/11 truth movement as kooky that Moyers and Parry simply accepted this view and never seriously looked at the best evidence? I suspect that this is part of the evidence. Although Parry charged truthers with being guilty of anti-empiricism, it is Parry and Moyers who have violated the need for empiricism about 9/11. for which I called, incidentally, in the lecture I gave in Seattle in 2007, 9/11, Let's Get Empirical. However, whereas Moyers and Parry's anti-empiricism about 9/11 is probably due in part to the spin machine, this surely cannot be the whole answer. Parry and Moyers both know how effective the spin machine can be with regard to any charge that would put the government in a bad light. So they would know the need to get behind the spin by examining the best evidence for the issue at hand. So why did they not do this with regard to 9/11? For many journalists and other people, the answer would be what I have called nationalist faith, the mythical belief that the American government would never deliberately do anything terribly evil. But Parry and Moyers have both reported stories that contradict this myth. We can distinguish, however, between the kinds of evils they have reported and the type of enormous evil to which Hitler alluded in his discussion of the big lie, in which he said, "Ordinary people more readily fall victims to the big lie than the small lie, since they themselves often tell small lies in little matters, but would be ashamed to resort to large-scale falsehoods. It would never come into their heads to fabricate colossal untruths, and they would not believe that others would have the impudence to distort the truth so infamously." I suspect that, although Moyers and Parry have been more than willing than most American journalists to expose ugly truths about American political and military leaders, they drew the line at 9/11. For American political leaders to have planned 9/11, they felt, would have been so evil, and the resulting lie would have been so colossal, that they could not believe that any American politicians, even Bush and Cheney, would have done it. The very idea that 9/11 could have been an inside job, Parry said, is preposterous. Any right-thinking person would know this, and so one could know the claim of the truthers to be false without delving into their arguments. One can know a priori, they seem to say, the falsity of their claim that explosives brought down the Twin Towers and Building 7. One does not need to know why the buildings came down to know that they were not brought down by explosives, because explosives would mean that it was an inside job, and this idea is preposterous. The truthers are so obviously wrong from their point of view that it is not necessary to study their writings. The truth about 9/11 is provided by the NIST reports and the popular mechanics books, both of which Parry recommended. Perhaps David Ray Griffin wrote a book criticizing popular mechanics and the NIST report on the Twin Towers, and another entire book on Building 7. But Moyers and Parry could know without reading them that these books could be safely ignored. Perhaps Moyers and Parry are now aware that the 9/11 truth movement contains hundreds of architects, engineers, lawyers, and scientists, but the very fact that these people have become truthers show that something must be wrong with their thought processes. This is my answer to the question, why do Bill Moyers and Robert Parry endorse the official story about 9/11, even though this story implies that massive miracles occurred on 9/11? Parry and Moyers have fallen for the big lie, whereas they would usually, as Norman Solomon said about Parry, follow the trail of truth wherever it leads. Moyers and Parry did not follow the trail of truth laid down by the 9/11 truth movement. Whereas Parry said that journalists should not accept patently absurd reasoning, he and Moyers accepted patently absurd claims about the Twin Towers and Building 7. Parry said that time spent on 9/11 means that real crimes get neglected. But 9/11 is the biggest crime in American history. Parry said consortiumnews.com, he started it because he feared that the decline of the U.S. press corps foreshadowed disasters that would come when journalists failed to alert the public about impending dangers. But Parry has not used consortium.news to inform the public about the dangers that will continue to grow every year that the truth about 9/11 is not exposed. Parry rightly said that the fight for honest information is a battle for the future of American democracy. And Moyers said that he and Bill Coffin agreed a few years ago that democracy had reached a fork in the road, one fork of which leads to an America where military power serves empire rather than freedom. But nothing has promoted American imperialism and distorted American democracy more than the big lie about 9/11. An example of this big lie at work, I have suggested, is that even Bill Moyers and Robert Parry, two of our best journalists, fell for it. One of the next steps for the 9/11 truth movement, I propose, is to focus on the relatively small number of journalists who are both in this country, who are both honest and courageous, trying to help them, starting with Moyers and Parry themselves, to see that the 9/11 big lie is indeed a lie. Thank you very much.